Hi.
What's my religious background?
I took a shot.
Yeah.
First of all, I want to compliment you on being the only person on NBC News who did not have to talk about a significant disease or family crisis at an athlete, because you're not allowed to do any Olympic coverage without it. You got away with it.
I know. You know, the only other time I'd been to an Olympics was 1992. I think it was 92 at the Atlanta Games. Maybe it was 96.
Six.
96. And for a New Yorker writer, it's a kind of a terrible thing, because each day there's a great story, and each day it gets written up in full in the Times or wherever. And I was running out of things to write, and so I ended up writing about television and how they cover the Olympics and the quote-unquote feminization of sports coverage that NBC, well, Rune Arledge really developed first by, you know, so-and-so is about to go down on something called a luge. But let's stop, and we then focus on his
raising
mother.
Six children.
Six.
Shingles in
six.
The family.
27 children,
right.
All of them without knees.
Right.
Very unfortunate illness.
Yeah. So. And yet. With three limbs missing. The luge, by the way, I have often pointed out, is the only event you can compete in if you are dead.
No, there's one called the skeletal.
Yeah, the skeleton,
it's
actually more
so
appropriate.
Great.
Okay.
You're wearing nothing but lycra, which reveals, I must tell you, Jeff, everything. And you get on the sled the size of one of those flexible flyers, and you go basically drop down an elevator shaft.
Well.
It's a great sport.
Just one more note. The biathlon has family history, because the idea, Gentiles on skis with guns is the last thing my grandparents saw.
Very scary.
I think.
Very scary.
Lean.
Yeah.
The old
very
country.
Scary.
Of course, in Russia, they wouldn't have the biathlon. It would be the heteroathlon. Okay, enough of this stuff. Because we get serious business.
That's how they invaded Crimea, by the way.
Well,
skis.
I'm sure that's true. But, okay, so we have this vote today. I did see the last, they don't take exit polls, I think.
No.
About 95%.
Roughly.
Roughly. And the question that leaps out is, what's Putin up to? I've seen articles just this very day. There are people in Russia who are hoping that he wants to reconstitute something like the Soviet Union.
Mm.
There's another Stalinist now come to prominence on the media. Maybe he wants to reignite the Cold War. So the question is, what is he up to here?
Let me just say this. What he's not, and this is another meme, is crazy. There's a meme out there that somehow Putin has lost his mind. That's not what this is about. Let's go back. Remember, this is one generation ago, 25 years ago, 24 years ago, the Soviet Union collapsed. The ideology absolutely disappeared. Nobody gave a damn about that except for people on the margins, some old people who still had dreams of communism. But mostly people cared about, if they cared at all, about power, the state. And suddenly it fractured. It fractured into 15 different states, highly various. The Baltic states are tiny, more liberal, tied to Sweden and the West. And then you had other places like Central Asia, which inevitably became far, far more conservative, troubled in many other different ways. The disease of what empire was under the Soviet Union is, and the psychology and nostalgia is still very powerful, even a generation later. Post-imperial nostalgia happened when the Ottoman Empire collapsed, Austro-Hungarian Empire collapsed, Roman Empire, and it goes on and on and has political ramifications. Who was Vladimir Putin? He's an ex-KGB man. He was invested in the Soviet Union far more than his two predecessors, who managed to, after all, collapse it. So now you have also a situation where there are many Russians that live outside of the Russian Republic, in northern Kazakhstan, Ukraine, even the Baltic states, Belarus, and so on. And this gives him a pretext to do something that we consider, and I consider, inadmissible, which is to invade a sovereign country. Now, Putin hears that, and he smiles, and he says, where have I heard that before? Invading a sovereign country. I'm not going to accept any lectures on that. So the you begin to form a mental universe here. Why Crimea? Because Crimea is heavily Russian, and it was a particular part of Ukraine that Khrushchev, on a seeming whim, in mid-century gave away to Ukraine.
Which didn't mean anything at the time in practice.
It meant less than it does now, because it was all part of the Soviet Union. And like our base in Guantanamo, after the collapse of the Soviet Union, Russia retained military base at the tip, the southern tip of Crimea in Sevastopol. Its fleet, the Black Sea Fleet, is still there. So they watched the events in Ukraine. Putin watched those events in Ukraine, in a divided country, and felt betrayed.
Just to be clear, the events when Yanukovych was deposed, when a new bunch of people came in Kiev and basically were turning west.
Right. Ukraine is not to oversimplify it, but for just sketch purposes, the eastern and southern part of Ukraine is heavily Russian, and the rest of it is heavily Ukrainian. From a Russian point of view, a lot Ukrainian nationalism is infected also by right-wing and extremist nationalism, even Nazis, but the idea that somehow Nazis were at the forefront of the Ukrainian uprising on Maidan Independence Square is crazy. It's a pretext. This is a very familiar pattern that Putin is using. Russians are crying in for help. Our brothers are in trouble. We go in and help them out. That's the pattern that's going on here. And the vote was just,
Does this suggest that where other Russians are encased, if I can use that word, in now independent countries, we might expect the same thing to happen?
Well, look, 2 weeks before the invasion of Crimea, I would have thought it would be an act of madness, craziness. Now I would think the same about eastern Ukraine. What's happening there? Well, there are troops massing right to the north of eastern Ukraine, near Kharkov and Donetsk and all the rest. So I wish I knew what the barrier of Putin's gall is. I do not. And he's become, by the way, he's become distinctly more anti-Western, angrier, and more aggressive than in the beginning.
You wrote a piece in which you suggested that this might be Putin's undoing, and you pointed to disaffection inside Russia with what was going on in Crimea. Now, I don't know to what extent polls mean anything there, but there's a story that he's now at a relatively high point in popularity. And more to the point, there's been a whole series of crackdowns on independent news media, young
right.
journalists, outlets that have been suddenly shut down. So the question is, if this is to be a domestic problem for Putin back in Russia, doesn't he have...
It can only be a domestic problem if the West exerts sufficient strength to make it so.
Does the West have the tools to do that?
I think in no way are we talking about a military option, and thank goodness. That's just not on the charts for anybody, and it's just not happening. But the West does have the capacity to exert economic and diplomatic pressure on Russia. Remember, Russia, unlike the Soviet Union, lives in the global world. It lives in the global economy. It sells its oil. It sells its gas. Its very, very wealthy people take their capital and they get it out to the West as fast as they can. They send their kids to Harvard and Columbia and Yale and Oxford and Cambridge. Russians live in the world. If that world suddenly becomes closed to them, then repercussions begin to happen. You also have to think about what is the mental universe of an average Russian in terms of information. State television, before all this happens, state television is totally and utterly run by the Kremlin. It has its own officers running it. There's a blacklist of who cannot appear on Russian television. The rhetoric, the anti-Western rhetoric on Russian television is vile. And all I would say, if you don't speak Russian, and I'm guessing there are a few of you here in the room, if you want to understand, have a taste of what Russian state television is like, watch RT, which used to be called Russia Today, with that green RT insignia. It will also give you a sense of Putin's mental universe, his collection of resentments against the West, his notion of what his interests are, Russia's interests are. He is creating step by step, by crushing independent media, and by creating a kind of new neoconservative Russian ideology, a sense of what Russianness is and should be on the state level.
So this brings us to the question of if there is pressure of some kind to be exerted from the West, let's look here at home. And I, you know, I was struck by the headline in yesterday's Times under or over an op-ed piece by Senator John McCain. Obama made America look weak.
Oh, for God's sake.
Well, let me further annoy you. Because he says, well,
not
of
that
course,
I have any opinions.
He said,
about
of, you understand he wrote that piece, not
yeah,
me.
Okay. Yeah, I got that. Sorry, Jeff.
No, blaming the messenger, yeah. I know, of all people.
I know. But, it's because you didn't share the winter with us. I
that's
feel
true, right?
And non-fraternal
likely, likely never will again.
Yeah, exactly.
And which of us is the dummy?
Kane or
her. Okay. So, so McCain says, okay, look, I'm certainly not blaming Obama for this. The blame lies with Putin. But, he says, Putin saw a lack of resolve in President Obama. He fed a perception, Obama did, that America is weak, and people like Mr. Putin, for people like Putin, weakness is provocation.
Yeah. Well, this is it's this goes back to their election and where did they first split on Iraq? Who was right about Iraq, Putin or Barack Obama? Barack Obama is president today.
Putin or McCain?
I'm sorry. Obama is president today because in large measure he was right about Iraq. That's where his division with Hillary Clinton came. McCain and many of us were wrong. We're wrong. Syria is an incredible, this is the most recent ramification.
Well, that's relevant because people like Lindsey Graham and McCain have said,
want to invade everywhere.
Weakness in Syria also helped Putin do this.
Absolutely. See, I think Syria is the most recent relevant subject here. Now, what is McCain suggesting? He's saying, well, of course it's not Barack Obama's fault. And of course I'm not suggesting we go to war. What I'm suggesting is that we have economic sanctions, which is precisely what's going on. So this is just political nonsense, I have to say. And McCain's sophistication on the Ukrainian question is such that when he went to Kiev, and I'm glad he went to Kiev, that's great, he managed to stand next to a neo-Nazi politician. That's bad advance work. Now, look, I don't doubt the sincerity of John McCain, but I think he's twisting up in knots what policy is in the United States at this moment. I don't know what he's suggesting. If he's not suggesting a military option and economic sanctions are coming into play, it seems to me political gamesmanship. And that's not useful.
Is there? Let me just broaden this out a bit, because the argument's been around for a very long time, long before Obama became president, that weakness on the part of a great power like the United States is dangerous because it feeds appetites. You know, Osama bin Laden was once quoted as saying that people favor the strong horse over the weak horse. And people have gone to examples ranging from Carter in Iran to Reagan's pulling out of the Marines in Lebanon after the barracks were bombed in 83, to any one of failure to really find al-Qaeda. This sense that when a great power shies away from strong action, people are encouraged. It may even go all the way back to Munich and World War II. Is there anything to the argument that, for instance, the Syria seemed to show Obama at least clumsily stepping one way and then another way? Bright lines, or do you disagree?
I have enormous rage about Syria insofar as what's happening and the number of people who've been killed there, the use of chemical weapons, the use of primitive weapons, etc. But one cannot deny the political complexity of what Syria is, and almost from the start, and certainly what it is now. The use of force for humanitarian means is a highly complex issue. It has sometimes worked, up to a point in American history, and sometimes it's been our undoing. And we need to think 1,000 times before we do it. A lot of this is the politics of predecessors and successors. There's no question. I think there is no question that Barack Obama's behavior in Syria is conditioned by what he saw going wrong deeply, especially in Iraq. Let's remember the ramifications of what happened in Iraq, and to this day, the degree to which our standing in the world, not only by Abu Ghraib and torture and all the things that came after, but also just the pretense of going to war on the basis of weapons of mass destruction that were not there. This was an enormous blow and absolutely does influence Obama. Now you have to then say, but Iraq can't last forever. Syria is not Iraq. Okay, but it does behoove us to look very, very carefully at what Syria actually is, what the opposition is, how fractured it is. What would it mean for us to go in? I think, you know, I did, as you mentioned in the introduction, I did a long piece on Obama, and I asked him all about Syria. And I don't think you can say that he hasn't thought it through. You may disagree radically. You may be in, and I think there I have more, I don't agree with McCain, but I think his political emotions and logic stand for themselves. Here on Ukraine, it seems to be more grandstanding.
There's an allied question here, because all of the people on the Republican side, when they ask, you know, when they attack Obama, they say, well, he should have done what Reagan would have done,
whatever that was.
Let me just lay the groundwork for a second. Clearly, in 1981, when the Soviet Union cracked down on Poland, Reagan sent exactly as many troops in as Obama did. I think there was a TV special that urged people to light a candle in the window. Mm-hmm. Okay. On the other hand, their argument is, yes, but after 8 years of increasing defense spending and encouraging on resistance, the Soviet Union was kind of forced into putting into power, after the last two guys died, Gorbachev, who took a look, and in fact, when the Velvet Revolution began, when dissent began to foment in Prague, Budapest, Warsaw, Eastern, he didn't send in troops. And the argument is the reason why Gorbachev stayed his hand was because he looked at Reagan and saw a firm leader in the West who would not.
I believe I know the argument. And every Republican convention since then, this is an article of ecclesiastical faith. Ronald Reagan won the Cold War. Well, let's go back. Who instituted human rights as a strong principle of American foreign policy? That well-known weakling, Jimmy Carter. It's like when you talk about New York City, why did the crime rates go down? Who built up the police force in this city? Who really began to build up the police force in this city and change policing? David Dinkins. Not to say that Rudy Giuliani and they all didn't have a role, although his role was also negative, I feel, Giuliani in policing. But these things are complex. And the cartoonization of something like the collapse of the Soviet Union is maddening.
I would point out, however, that one of the people
Can I just add to that?
Yeah, please.
I think Ronald Reagan, though, deserves enormous credit, because unlike almost everybody else in the Republican leadership at that time, he took a leap of faith, famously urged by his wife, to put some chips on, to believe in the possibility of the sincerity of Mikhail Gorbachev.
Yeah.
And that had enormous historical consequences. But when the Republican Party goes on about how Ronald Reagan won the Cold War, that's not what they mean.
Okay. I just would point out that one of the people who gives credit to Reagan more than you might expect is Sean Wilentz, who is a prominent liberal historian.
I think Sean is absolutely
right. And the only reason I'm making that is on the other side, you hear people say, oh, it had nothing to do with Reagan, it was Gorbachev. It was like, and I think, you know, it seemed to me that Reagan gets his...
I think if some other kind of Republican had been in office there, or a Democrat having to show how tough he was, you might have had a very different result.
That's okay. So, since we've cleverly gone from Crimea to Crimea and Obama,
you want to talk about the cartoons?
Let's We're going to Obama.
Okay.
Yes, thank you.
Okay.
Because indeed, you had an extraordinary amount of time with him, traveled with him, and it came at a fortuitous time in that this is the late winter of his discontent in many ways.
Yeah.
He came off a pretty bad 2013.
Terrible,
okay. His approval ratings are down to a point where they threaten Democrats in the midterm, I mean, if you believe that the connection, and there is one. So I guess the first question is, taken from your experience, does Obama see himself as in a bad spot right now?
You know, it's interesting, and I'm sure you've had this experience covering politics. I think that these people are intelligent. Of course they know, they can read a poll, but they live in an enclosed universe where they're telling themselves stuff all the time.
The phrase often used is
bubble. Bubble, kind of bullshit mountain, I think they call it. John Stewart
Better.
Calls Fox. But
Better.
But everybody, all human beings have their own bullshit mountain, right? We all have things that we cling to. The thing that the president clings to is the impossibility of getting anything done in Washington. Now, there's a lot of reality about that, and it's never been more dire, at least in my memory. I'm sure it's been
pretty
bad.
Yeah.
So that depresses them no end. And there is this kind of, to Obama, in the way he talks, a kind of elegiac flavor, which he's, by the way, given to anyway. There is this kind of professorial
elegiac bearing. In the sense that it's done?
Not that it's done, but there had been, in his terms, so much promise, so much that he wanted to do and transform. I guess all presidents, most presidents come to office feeling that way. And what he's left with is so much more incremental than he would have imagined. And the one gigantic thing that he achieved rolled out, well, that's enough with the obscenities. It just was a disaster.
It's what Jimmy Carter called an incomplete success.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. Yeah. The healthcare.
Healthcare. I mean, that was the worst kind of wound of all. You take a pistol and you shoot yourself in the knee. Right. It was self-inflicted.
Yeah.
With a lot of help, by the way, right, from Bullshit Mountain. But the technological rollout of that was just inexcusable.
I mean, I was thinking about this just today. I mean, this is one of those horrible Rotary Club cliches that actually has, you never get the second chance to make a first impression.
Right.
So that George H.W. Bush lost in 92 in part because of a recession that had ended before the election year ever started. Or Giuliani got a lot more credit for the crime than he might have because Dinkins beefed up the police force before he was voted out of office.
Right.
So what I'm getting at is that for the rest of this election year, it's entirely possible that the electorate's framework for affordable health care will be the website that may well be working fine now.
Seems to be working okay now, but you know, TikTok, as we used to say in the movement, and once you get past the midterms, the quacking of the duck begins. And this year has not exactly been all that active either. So and what is the newspaper filled with? Hillary, Hillary, Hillary.
Right.
Republican Party. CPAC just had its convention, which was very inspiring. And so so here we are,
right,
yet again, looking down the long tunnel at the next contest, the Bacchanalia.
This is the part of this process that, as long as I've seen it, it just gets worse and worse.
Yeah, and earlier and earlier.
Yeah, I mean, I would amend the First Amendment to forbid any mention of this campaign until 12, and not let any non-citizen go to Iowa or New Hampshire either. But that's not going to happen. But the question then is, several, I hope. First being, so what does Obama do in this stretch? I'm smiling because I just remember reading a New York Times thing saying that in the fading Obama presidency, he's got 3 years left on his term.
That's a lot.
Yeah, and that's a fair amount of time.
Right.
But given what you're describing, you know, the rush to the next election, the strong possibility that both houses of Congress are going to be in Republican hands.
Very
what,
strong.
What does an Obama do?
Foreign policy for one thing.
Okay.
It would be nice to see the current crisis at least severely limited, because our imagination is now, our political imaginations are running to the catastrophic and with justification. John Kerry, when he's not running to hither, thither, and yon with Sergei Lavrov, has been shuttling between Ramallah and Jerusalem and Washington a lot, a subject possibly in this room that has been discussed. And I think you're going to think I'm crazy. I think there's promise there. And if there's not, I think that's a deeply, deeply dark day. On the Palestinian-Israeli question, there has to be substantial progress there, or things are going to go backward in a way that seems to me very, very dark indeed. There's an Iranian nuclear issue that is still that has not been resolved. I feel that ball has been moved forward in a positive way, but to think of it as resolved is naive in the extreme. So foreign policy has some huge issues, and we're leaving some out as well. Do I think there's going to be a domestic achievement on the level of healthcare? The answer to that one is pretty obvious. You know, there's a lot of talk. I think Obama thinks the best he can do is tee up certain subjects so that successors down the line can get to them more readily. One of them is income, and the opportunity gap in this country grows more and more severe all the time. And I know that he cares a lot about that, not just in a kind of banal and cliched way, right, but for real.
I want to get to that, but I want to keep it about Obama a little bit more broad. Because, okay, so the argument that his defenders will have is, look, you know, we have a completely obstinate opposition. You know, people like Bill Kristol, not the comedian, the commentator, said at the very beginning, we can't give him health care because it'll help us politically.
Yeah.
I want him to fail, said Rush Limbaugh. And yet you also have people, not particular conservatives, AP's longtime reporter turned columnist, Ron Fournier, is that how you pronounce his name, had a piece saying it is Obama's fault because he knew this terrain and he wasn't clever enough to figure out what to do about it.
Yeah, neither is Ron Fournier. In other words, I don't know what he's suggesting by that.
Well,
there are a couple of myths about it, not myths.
You know, he's too, I'll help you out, he's too aloof.
That's it. So last night, I was having dinner with a politician, and boy, was he going on about that.
Very clever.
It was pretty good, huh?
Yeah, unless it was transgender,
that was
which
not
is a whole other issue.
Okay. And really, you know, bad politician, doesn't like people, doesn't like politics. This is an imprinted thing in Washington life.
Right, absolutely.
People who hold office in Washington, in the Democratic Party, almost equally to the Republican Party, feel that, you know, if only he had more dinner and played more golf with, wait for it, them, that somehow politics in Washington would be transformed, that the Republican Party would relinquish its, the Tea Party influence people and the people in the pretty hard right would relinquish their ideology and vote otherwise because of golf or dinner or whatever. I really think that's just silly. Always the counterexample is Lyndon Johnson.
Ah, yes.
So, of sainted memory, really, Lyndon Johnson? Lyndon Johnson, and if Robert Caro, who should be here to say these things, if Barack Obama had the kind of majorities and also the kind of historical emotional force of coming after a martyred popular president to his, you'll forgive me, advantage, then you would be able to pass the civil rights, voting rights, Medicare, et cetera.
Let me just turn this, because I mean, everything you've said, I think, is absolutely right. People forget it's the emotional impact of the assassination. It's a Southern veteran of the Senate who could deal with the old Bourbons who ran the committees. And the incidental fact that he had huge majorities, not just of Democrats, but half the Republicans in the Senate were moderates and liberals.
This state had a liberal Republican that I would say Jacob Javits is probably more liberal than Chuck Schumer in many ways.
I don't even know how to deal with that, but fine. But I'm thinking, I mean, it's Javits, and it's Case, and it's a whole, okay. All that being said, the question, now.
Mark Hatfield.
Now, since you had dinner with a politician.
Yeah.
I, some months ago, had dinner with a important Washington person.
Yes.
And this, he, she, it, a veteran of Democratic Party stuff.
I know who that is.
Yeah. Yeah, okay. Well, anyway, Jaime said...
That's my father-in-law.
He said, his argument was slightly different. He said of the White House, and you'll hear this a lot about people outside, they think they know everything. They simply will not listen. Now, I don't know whether that's a slightly different rap than he won't play golf with the Republicans. But there's an arrogance in the White House that won't let them.
There are grains of truth in all things like this. Barack Obama is not a relentless, kibitzer. He does not make 3 o'clock in the morning phone calls to, he's not Bill Clinton. I mean, Bill Clinton is the most amazing political creature I have ever met in my lifetime.
No doubt.
It's like Michael Jordan in basketball.
No doubt.
But one might remember that he was flawed in some ways as well.
It's come up.
All people are. If Barack Obama was such a shitty politician, his name is Barack Hussein Obama and he's black and he was elected president after 5 minutes in the Senate.
Yeah.
That's pretty skillful. Now, that doesn't answer all questions.
That's skillful. That's
just
skillful
not,
political.
Jeff, that doesn't answer all questions, and you could reasonably ask, okay, that's one thing.
Right.
But dealing with Putin and Ahmadinejad and his successor and Netanyahu is quite another. And I will not sit here and think that he's been perfect in this in any which way. But to say he's a bad politician, 14 human beings in the history of America have been reelected president of the United States. He's one of them.
The disapproval that he is experiencing, interestingly enough, is shared among one of his core constituencies, which is younger people.
Yeah.
And I offer you a hypothesis which you can either readily embrace or shoot down. And I think a part of it has to do with the whole broad area of privacy, the Snowden revelations about the NSA data gathering, which, to trigger another cliche, I think had it happened under George Bush and Dick Cheney, would have produced on the left an absolute explosion of outrage, and which still has produced strong discontent.
Correct.
Okay. So in this sense, now we're not talking about playing golf, now we're not talking about schmoozing, we're talking about substantive decisions in which, to the people who invested a lot of hope in Obama, look very odd, to say the least.
Yeah, I think you're right. I think young people who get involved in politics with great enthusiasm when they're young are headed for disappointment inevitably. This is a dark, weird, disappointing, tragic world that we live in, especially in the realm of public affairs, and not only. But I think you're absolutely right. I think the people who published in the Washington Post, the Guardian, et cetera, deserve a Pulitzer Prize next month. I really do. Is Snowden a complicated and problematic figure?
Yeah.
Sources often are, Jeff. They often are. I think the journalists did a first-rate job, and so far as I could see, they have not published anything that's a threat to the Republic. I think it's an enhancement to the health of the Republic to know these things.
By the way,
and I think a lot of people feel that way, and I think you're right, a lot of young people who, not just because of their intense interest in the web, and none of us live outside of the web, except for you. You haven't learned email yet, I know. that this is a very serious thing.
Yeah, I also think it's the fact that because life is lived on the smartphone, it hits much closer to home.
But everybody.
In raising Snowden's name, I mean, problematic is a nice...
It's a Weasley word.
No, I didn't, but I mean, it yeah, okay. At some point, does someone like that, even though the information he disgorges is of great value, need to face criminal prosecution?
I think that's going to happen. It's hard for me to imagine he's just going to stay in Russia forever.
Yeah.
I don't, and there have been hints, Jeff, haven't there, that the Justice Department would love to find a way to bring this to some resolution. Not that they'll say, come on home and you can live out the rest of your life in Hawaii, but I get the feeling, and it's based on the narrowest band of kind of information, so I couch it that I know next to nothing. I don't think it's anybody's interest in the United States that he sits there in Russia for the rest of his life,
yeah.
Much less Snowden.
one of the things that Obama has put on the table, you referred to the fact that he may be hoping to tee up issues. The opportunity gap, income and wealth inequality, the speech in Kansas, which
right.
on the centenary of Teddy Roosevelt's speech.
Right.
And yet at the same time, and here's something that may transcend the ability of any president who even wanted to do something about it. You've got a healthy majority in the country saying income inequality is getting worse and it's a bad thing. When you ask them whether government as an institution can do anything, either about that or damn near anything else,
right.
the numbers, there's been a real shift, you know, perceptible shift over the last generation. Just people who used to think, yeah, I think the government's an instrument for redressing, they don't believe that.
I think that's what the Reagan Revolution was all about, and that exists to this day, which is why Ronald Reagan is such a powerfully important president in post-war history. And it not just because of the Cold War, but because he changed the terms of the debate about the scale and role of government in a way that nobody else had on that side of the ledger. He was the real embodiment of conservatism. And you can see how he's used as a banner to this day, because who else? Bush the elder was not an ideological conservative, and Bush the younger is an embarrassment, I think, to the party. So Reagan is that.
Yes,
and I think Sean Wilentz, nobody's written about this better than Sean Wilentz, who's at Princeton, that the Reagan Revolution, which probably began in the 70s, actually, with the rise of neoconservatism and the normalization of conservatism under William F. Buckley in the pages of the National
and
Review.
And deregulation, which was a Jimmy Carter.
Absolutely, and also the flushing out from conservatism by Buckley of the kind of freaks and anti-Semites and the rest, has a powerful influence today. I've heard Obama talk about this, about this Reagan Revolution lasting now for into its fourth decade.
But there's another part of that about this, which is if you go back a couple of generations and people's experience, what was people's experience with government, right? Well, it was Roosevelt who was a rallying figure, and it was people being put back to work. And even if it was World War II, then into the Depression, there was Social Security, and labor unions were being recognized. And we won World War II, and we built the interstate highway system.
But all of these things are under ideological threat.
But there's a different, okay. And we had the GI Bill of Rights, and we had all of that, right? So if you grew up or resonate with that, if your parents remembered that, that's what it meant to be. Okay, now let's fast forward a generation, okay? Starting, say, after John Kennedy's assassination, coincidental or not, you have, at the high watermark of American liberalism, you follow fairly quickly, you have a devastating war in Vietnam. You have the black-white coalition ripping apart in the streets of the cities. You have Watergate, and you have then a combined inflation, recession, deindustrialization of the country, in which the government seems unable to do much of anything. So the question is...
But you also had, Jeff, a Voting Rights Act, a Civil Rights Act,
1965,
a reduction in poverty. One of the dilemmas is that it is absolutely true that the division is larger, but the number of poor is smaller. So you have this also this psychological aspect of there's this small, small, small elite that lives in kind of a skybox existence, and when it is even suggested, for example, that carried interest rates be taxed at a normal rate, a very famous private equity guy gets up and says that this is like Hitler invading the Sudetenland. There's a disjunct of the realities and the perceptions of America.
I'm not sure I've got phrased the question right. It seems to me there is a generation of Americans that experience government as either malevolent or ineffectual, in sharp contrast to the generation that preceded it. And that was what it helped lay the groundwork for what Reagan was able to convince people of.
True.
I don't think these things happen in a vacuum. Barry Goldwater made much of the same arguments and suffered a historic political defeat.
But he said he laid the groundwork.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But it took events, in my view, to persuade the electorate, at least a pretty healthy majority, to say, you know what, maybe this isn't so
crazy. I take your point.
Okay. So the question then is...
As H.L. Mencken used to answer every letter of complaint,
you may be right.
And I think you are in this case.
Well, okay. Then I'll look forward to the letter. I mean, the idea is, and your pages have had, I'm pretty clear, or I'll embarrass myself, that George Packer wrote a lot of what he wrote for you, right?
Yeah, sure.
The Unwinding.
Yeah.
Which is a devastating, unbelievably powerful, interlocking series of stories about what's happened to the country. But at the end of the day, I hate that phrase, sorry. But after all that, when somebody says, and here's what we're going to do about it, you know, okay.
The resistance to that is powerful.
Well, what is, but take me one step before the resistance. What are those steps?
Well, for example, tax rates. Any if you are not allowed to, unless you think that the deficit is the most important economic discussion in the country, you're not allowed into the room with the average Republican now. You're considered crazy. The argument over austerity versus stimulus has changed radically in the last 30 years. This is why, you know, Paul Krugman made his bones on the Times op-ed page because of his extremely hard-headed and correct opposition to the Bush presidency. But it's, you know, after Iraq began to fade from consciousness, it's the economic arguments that he's making that I think are so important, and the levels of corruption that have been excused or overlooked by those very same conservatives. It's inexplicable to me, inexplicable. There were failures of government and led to the crash in 2008-2009. There were failures of government. This is all wasn't some half a dozen investment banks' fault.
No, but I think it's important to say that some of those failures were rooted in the administration of Bill Clinton.
They're absolutely true. Absolutely true. And, you know, this is part of the discussion we're going to have in the next 18 months when it comes to Hillary Clinton. I think I don't want to anticipate that race over much because there's no journalist in America that has counseled more often on television against hastiness and overprediction about American politics than Jeff Greenfield has, and absolutely rightly. But that's coming like Christmas.
It sure is.
Or Tu B'Shvat, or whatever you like to. One way or another, it's coming.
It's okay.
It's all right.
You got to know your territory.
You got to play.
It's a very good recovery. but there is a valid point to be made looking ahead. I'm sorry to do this, but I was talking just last week.
Please. To a very important.
Well. One who might actually be involved in the process.
Right.
And she was saying that, I'm going to adopt this one,
in
it's
fairness,
great,
I
it's
started
really wonderful.
It. Yeah, thank
it's
you.
It's terrific.
Thank you.
That the next Democratic candidate may have to veer fairly sharply away from Obama in the sense of being much tougher about the sources of income and wealth inequality and you know, where they reside. I think the point is, there's a certain amount of...
Yeah, but where is Obama on that? In other words, he raises the subject, but this is not going anywhere fast in Congress, and he's not proposing much.
More to the... And the other point, which was documented pretty well in, I think, in your piece, is, you know, every so often he flees Washington and hangs out with precisely these people to extract as much money as possible from them, because that's the campaign.
That's the system.
I know.
This is a crazy system.
Yes, it is.
This is crazy. We empower plutocrats to have an inordinate influence on the election of our elected officials. And by the way, it's not just the Koch brothers. It's not just the Koch brothers.
No.
It's whoever can ante up. Look, what is the moral dilemma? I'm going to, oh boy, here we go. What is the moral dilemma that we faced in this city in the last dozen years? If your politics are like mine, well, you had the richest citizen in the city buy the election. He ran, but he also bought the election three times, changed the rules the third time, It was like, now, and in many ways, I liked him as a mayor. When I hear a guy that's worth that much money saying he's going to give it all away and leave a modest inheritance to his kids, or whatever he counts as modest, that is an amazing behavior by plutocratic standards in this country. Amazing. And I think he did a lot of good. But there was something systemically anti-democratic about it. And the reaction, in part, is the campaign of Bill de Blasio. And I wish him all the best, and I hope it goes well, and et cetera, et cetera. But you can't ignore that dynamic.
Yeah.
And we get up on our high horse about Berlusconi or this kind of behavior elsewhere. This, you know, we like Mike Bloomberg a great deal more than Silvio Berlusconi, God knows.
This, by the way, raises a question about The New Yorker.
Sure.
And it's almost as on track with what you've been talking about, because one of the things, if you read The New Yorker in print, a medium that will be around for a while.
I hope so.
You have this odd disconnection, or as people ungrammatically say, disconnect, mm-hmm. is that I'm reading the stories by George Packer and others, powerfully documenting the consequences of great plutocratic wealth. And every page I turn, there's an ad for a $25,000 watch.
Here's what I would say. Here's what I would say, Jeff. There aren't enough pages with ads with $25,000.
Well,
there used to be more.
See, there's a shock. Or as they say in My Cousin Vinny without the adjective, there's an effing surprise. I just meant that, look, there's no moral issue here. It's just a kind of a strange thing. I'm reading about the mother, single mother of four kids, trying to build a life for herself in a town in Ohio, and she's on welfare and she's eating.
This is the freakish formula in the last, say, century and a half that led to possibly the best journalism in the history of the world, which is this combination of advertising, a First Amendment, et cetera. It's now in danger. It's now in danger. And I've lived elsewhere where they didn't have that formula. I'm not so sure we like it. Now we have, I think the future for us is to continue getting as many ads as we possibly can and living with that, what you see as a contradiction. I can sleep through the night on that. But also, quite frankly, saying to the reader, okay, the old business of you having a subscription for next to nothing, that doesn't work for me anymore. That doesn't work. Same thing with the New York Times. The New York Times, you probably have noticed, your subscription is quite a bit more expensive than it was 15 years ago. There are also fewer ads. They need to be healthy in order to have a Moscow bureau and put people on planes and pay people a fair wage and all those things. I think the New Yorker and the New York Times are doomed to success. And what I mean by that is by keeping your standards as high as you can keep them and keep pushing them higher and higher and doing the best you can and having that be your ultimate value, there will be an audience for it.
Well, there's
they will pay. A
there's
fair
evidence
price
for that. I mean, financial.
It won't be everywhere.
Right, and that's the trick.
The business in America, the business of having 20 really great newspapers, that's really doomed. That's really problematic.
So you've got your, because you have examples. The Economist does pretty well financially. Not the most compelling, you know. We got to
do
read
a certain thing, Jeff. They give
that's
you a picture
point
of the world.
Yeah. Financial Times, yeah. New Yorker, one hopes. The New York Times, but
we're doing very well, by the way. We are.
The Times, but how about the Times?
Can't speak for the Times.
Okay.
I think the Times was hurt less by the strategy that we're talking here. They made some bad choices in the last 50. That's like what teachers tell the parents. Johnny's making some bad choices in school.
No. You can't say that.
It's inappropriate.
Challenging choice.
Challenging choice.
Problematic choice.
Problematic.
You set fire to the gym. That's a.
I think, in retrospect, buying the Boston Globe for $1 billion
and selling it for
59 cents was not an ideal investment, but
yeah.
We all make mistakes.
Do you, but can you assure an audience, I'm taking a wild guess here, that likes print, That we will see a print edition of The New Yorker 25 years from now?
Yeah, I think so. Okay. I look, I don't know where the balance will be in terms of who will be reading it on a screen, who will be reading it in print. A print magazine like The New Yorker is a pretty good technology. The Sunday Times is not a great technology. When The Sunday Times lands outside our door on Sunday morning, my sons think it's like a dead dog. You know, the stuff is falling out, and then the ad supplements. But it is democracy itself. I mean, it's a great thing. You read it online.
I have to tell you, there were times in the holiday season, when I've been tempted to take everything in the New York Times, put it in an envelope, and mail it to Arthur Sulzberger.
Yeah, I'm sure he'd enjoy that.
Yeah, I'm sure.
He'd like that.
Okay.
About as much as Abe Rosenthal used to like it when people on the street would stop him and they'd say, the ink comes off on my hands, and Abe Rosenthal would say, no, it doesn't. Intimidating man.
Indeed. So these are some questions from the audience. Do you believe Angela Merkel will fully support the sanctions?
Yeah.
She seems to have...
But the interests vary in Europe as opposed to the United States. The economic interests and the economic ties between Europe and Russia are a lot closer than the United States. They have a lot more to lose in this game, gas supplies and all the rest. And don't think when we start exerting sanctions, it won't come back in the other direction.
It's interesting, I think, that I did a panel out in California about fracking, which I'm really an expert on. one of the points that was raised was, you know, that this enormous potential bonanza of natural gas might turn out to be a pretty powerful weapon for the United States.
It already is.
It can say to Eastern Europe, you don't have to worry about Russia shutting off its gas. I mean, it's one of those weird connections. Question, what about 400,000 Ukrainian Jews? I think the point being, do they have cause for special concern here?
Speaking as someone whose grandfather on my father's side left Ukraine on a donkey as fast as he possibly could and ended up at Ellis Island, et cetera, I don't think anyone denies that there is such a thing as anti-Semitism in Ukraine, or name a whole bunch of other places too. But my understanding is that Jews in the last generation have not lived under fantastical duress in Russia, in Ukraine, and certainly are not in any great numbers waving in the Russian troops to save them from the brown shirts.
Are
there people like this? You bet there are. And there are in Russia, too. Russia's not invading itself to get rid of its anti-Semites either. So.
No, I can remember traveling in Hungary some years ago and Czechoslovakia or the Czech Republic. And there did less there, but there did seem to be this pattern that when the Soviet system collapsed and these countries became free, some very old and sometimes disturbing
stuff bubbles up. Absolutely.
Yeah. Was the expansion of NATO into Eastern Europe a mistake? I guess in that it seemed to be a provocation.
There's no question that Vladimir Putin resents it enormously. There's no question. Those nations wanted to be in NATO. You know, we sometimes treat these other countries as if they lack volition, that they lack will, they lack a political desire. Those countries wanted to be NATO member states. Okay. Now, Tom Friedman disagrees and believes we never should have done it because it would annoy Russia.
You don't agree?
No.
Okay. Given the Ukraine's physical proximity to Russia mm-hmm. and the meetings in Europe by which Yanukovych, the European Union, and others agreed to the terms of the departure, why were the Europeans and the U.S. so quick to abandon that agreement and recognize the Ukraine opposition? Wasn't that a provocation?
Look, overall, what's going on there? There's a competition going on both in Ukraine and in the outer in the West and in Russia. There is an out-and-out competition. And one of the problems with Ukrainian politics is that it has not, Ukraine has not yet gotten, I don't know who has, gotten the politicians it needs and deserves. So you had Timoshenko, who represented this tendency to push toward the West, who was as corrupt could be, and played the West off the East for her purposes. Yanukovych comes to office, and he is in the opposite mode. He's much more leaning toward Russia and the Russian speakers in the East and South, and he is as corrupt can be, and plays one half of the country off the other. This is not a tenable politics. It is also none of Russia's business. Ukraine is a sovereign state.
But maybe
and the invasion of a sovereign state is, at the very, very least, deeply problematic. It is not nothing.
Which, one of the most fascinating things in the piece you recently wrote about this area was that 20-something years ago, Alexander Solzhenitsyn, in the process of calling for pretty much the dismemberment of the Soviet
right.
Union, multi-party state, no more communism, and say, well, of course, Ukraine is Russia.
This is part of the psychology of a lot of Russians. Look, remember, Solzhenitsyn was not Sakharov. Andrei Sakharov was a kind of westernizing liberal. Alexander Solzhenitsyn, not to make cartoons of this, was much more in the nationalist dissident camp. Solzhenitsyn, in 1990, while living in Vermont, wrote an essay called Как нам обустроить Россия? How to revitalize, restore Russia. And to the surprise of a lot of people who really were uncomfortable with Solzhenitsyn and found him to be a reactionary, Solzhenitsyn called for democracy and the dissolution of the Soviet Union, but with an explanation. He felt that there needed to be a Slavic Union that would encompass northern Kazakhstan, which has many, many Russians, Ukraine, Belarus, and Russia. So even in the best of circumstances, in the kind of more liberal nationalist camp, this psychology existed. Certainly it did in 1990, and it does to this day.
Besides,
look, the great illusion was that the Soviet Union, the last real empire on Earth, unless you want to count us, would collapse and that everything would look like the Czech Republic, was an illusion. We were deluded and arrogant. We thought of the unipolar world and so on. So that was, you know,
everything was going to be. It's Fukuyama,
the end of history.
Yeah.
And the end of history is a much more complex essay than that. But that somehow that kind of liberal Western democracy was reaching an unstoppable apogee. Guess what?
You know, I mean, it's not relevant except by showing you illusions. I have a vivid memory in 1966. Of a meeting in Hawaii between South Vietnam, our ally, and the United States, when they were planning the new South Vietnamese constitution, mm-hmm. with a big debate about whether they should have a unicameral or bicameral legislature. Because mm-hmm. that was obviously the driving force behind
everything.
Yeah, behind Vietnam. Beside being anti-Bush, what is Obama's foreign policy doctrine? Is there one? Is there an Obama
yeah.
doctrine?
Yes, I think so. I think you could sketch it out this way, and it will leave, for some people here, some missing pieces. And remember, you can have a foreign policy, but it's not going to always work out the way you want. Number one, in the beginning, it was to withdraw in a sane, rational, safe, stable way, first from Iraq and then from Afghanistan. There were, God knows, that's a complicated story, particularly in Afghanistan, and it's not complete. Yet, and the ramifications of our withdrawal from Iraq are quite complex as well. Dexter Filkins, one of the great war correspondents in the history of this country, was just in Iraq for us and is doing a big piece. I think that's first and foremost in the early part of the term. I think that certainly the Iranian nuclear issue was high up on the list. I mean, an Israeli-Palestinian resolution was high up on the list. And there was also this notion of a turn. This was in the kind of romantic days when it was thought that this could happen, a turn toward Asia, that you would have to say that the great historical trend in the 21st century is the rise of China. How the United States reacted to that rise, would it be met with aggression or antipathy or cooperation or coexistence? That historically was a gigantic thing. Unfortunately, so much of our energies and attentions have been focused on the traditional place, on the Middle East, that I think it's fair to say that the China has not gotten anywhere near the focus that, that they had wanted. If by your question, you, do you mean, is he a realist, a liberal interventionist, or the all those other categories, I think he would say that those are old categories and he transcends them. This is part of Obamaism, this and part of his vanity, and also part of recognition that the world has changed, that he transcends these things. It was also the business that he transcended differences between red and blue. Now he says that was campaign rhetoric.
Okay. This gives me a chance as a small footnote to point out that when you hear the criticism of Obama, there is no president who is not faced with precisely the same analysis by his or someday her opponents.
Right.
It has been a foreign policy of bluster and indecision. Our allies are disheartened. Our enemies are encouraged. We have had X years of drift. And it's like one, in the days of typewriters, all that would be on one key.
Right, you have a save
if you were a speechwriter.
Now
it's function six.
Yeah.
Okay. David and I both, I think, were so eloquent about not trying to jump to the 2016 campaign.
Here we are.
That we had but one of our audience was particularly impressed because the question is, who do you think will be the GOP candidate? Jeb Bush?
Wow. I don't think his mother's going to let him run. You know who got the most? When I was taking my kid around to see colleges a while back, colleges that they're now finished with, and in the 08 race, and you know who was getting the most buzz on college campuses? Especially on the Eastern Corridor, who? Rand Paul. That the libertarian urge is so attractive to many people, because what does it comprise? It's a form of isolationism in foreign policy, which is a current that's always been around in American history. A certain degree of liberalism on what we call social issues, and then a kind of a deep conservatism on economic issues. I wouldn't count him out.
I wouldn't either, but I just want to point this out, that in 2008, in going around, particularly in New Hampshire, the most enthusiastic and largest crowds were crowds of college kids for Ron, his even more libertarian father. And Ron, I should also mention, raised huge sums of money.
Got no votes.
I'm not arguing, because Rand is a more polished version of Ron. You know, Ron Paul used to talk, his voice would come out at the top of his head end of his...
But can I just say, Jeff, one of Jeff Greenfield's best qualities, both in print and in television, he does that rare thing you're never supposed to do on television when asked a question and say, I have absolutely no idea.
That was my only answer. You're
which is why you lasted so long.
Yeah, that's why I'm not there anymore.
But, you know, I could name the obvious names, but none of them make any sense yet.
No, I mean, it really, honest to God, it's the besetting sin of, you know, I had a wonderful boss at Nightline, Tom Batak, who said the great thing about cable news is that it's 24 hours a day, and the really terrible thing about cable news is it's 24 hours a day. And you're seeing it now with this Malaysian story. It's a tragic story, probably, but it's almost to the point beyond parody.
Yeah.
You know, the guy comes to deliver lunch, what do you think happened to that plane?
Yeah.
Would you get on TV?
Yeah.
So I would agree, but...
I don't know. You know, the same characters are around. Chris Christie is in the shape he's in.
Yeah.
Et cetera.
Okay. I guess it's slightly less egregious to say, given what's happened the last X years with Obama, if a Democrat should prevail in 2016 with the current kind of Congress, you know, I'm almost wondering whether we're seeing, trust me, it's not a prediction. Every midterm favors the Republicans, every presidential year favors the Democrats, because the electorate is radically different, and that we could wind up having a period of time until there's some other thing in which nothing...
I think there are a lot of people that feel that we are now in the late Mannerist period of the Reagan Revolution. That the Reagan Revolution in its heart, again, I was no fan of it, but had proponents and had ideas that were coming out of a historical time that made a certain sense. It wasn't a party of no, 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 we won't, we won't, we won't, we refuse, we refuse. That's what this is now. Again, a little bit cartoonish, but that's kind of what it is. That's not what the Reagan Revolution was. Quite activist and had a lot of ideas, many of them, in my view, bad ideas, but ideas they were. I don't know what idea Mitch McConnell actually stands for.
He may be the worst example, as because his job is a majority leader to.
And he's not a Tea Party guy.
But ish. You know, you're beginning. You have people arguing, people like David Brooks, you know, Ross Douthat, the conservatives in the Times every liberal likes, who are looking at people and looking around the party and thinking there are people beginning to try to wrestle with some of these questions like income inequality. I don't know. I mean, this is not even a fertilized egg yet. But
well, you know, I was talking to, there's a guy named Robert Putnam who's at Harvard, who wrote a wonderful book called Bowling Alone about kind of social atomization, the dissolution of social groups, whether it's bridge clubs or social clubs or the 92nd Street Y, that there was less of this and he felt that this had a bad impact. Now he's working on social inequality. And he's been consulted by Obama quite a lot, but he told me he's also gotten visits from Paul Ryan and any number of people in the Republican Party. It's kind of interesting that it will be at the center of the debate come this next election. I couldn't say.
I think it would be a very good idea for the Republican Party not to have 16 debates in front of audiences, because I really think that, I think it throws people off. You know, I think you get the worst of that. Just a couple more. Is there any president whose accomplishments would compare to Barack Obama's? And second, will he be remembered as a successful president?
Will he be remembered as a successful president? I don't know about the first part, but I think if there is a resolution on a couple of these huge issues, foreign policy terms, and these withdrawals from war roughly work out, and I mean roughly, and healthcare persists, he has changed the equation on the most painful historical issue that the United States of America has ever had, race. And I can name any number of issues. I think yes. Is he Franklin Roosevelt? No. No, but I think in his terms, in his time, and given the limitations that he's working under politically and otherwise, and some of these big foreign policy questions can be resolved in the next 2.5 years, 3 years, I think yes.
Okay.
There's a lot of ifs in that paragraph.
And here's the question that begins with the very same word. If we had a new constitutional convention in, say, 2015, how would you redesign American government? Get rid of the Electoral College, ditch the dominance of the two-party system, create a House and Senate that actually function?
Yes, yes. You know, I have a great colleague named Henrik Hertzberg, and who you know from, who writes, the most elegant writer, and writes comment for us quite a lot. And his big issue that's outside the mainstream of the normal day-to-day things is constitutional reform. That believes, you know, he believes in the way we have the Senate structure that we have now is cockeyed, the party structure that we have is cockeyed. I think he'd prefer to have a parliamentary system and proportional representation, and a lot of these problems that we have would go away. The problem is, of course, we're not going to have a constitutional convention because governments and constitutions tend not to self-dissolve.
When you next see my old buddy Rick,
yeah,
who he is,
and he tries to sneak this into everything he writes, and we call it "Where's Waldo?" it's hiding right behind the preposition.
Would you remind Rick,
yeah,
that there is one part of the Constitution that says cannot be amended? It is that part that says no state shall be deprived of equal representation in the Senate without its consent. Now, this is a little bit like Superman, Captain Marvel. Can you amend an unamendable part of the Constitution? But that's how deeply rooted that was in the start. So I think you can take that and chuck it out the window.
Right, and we know from reading the Federalist Papers in history why these things
Okay, but the
occurred.
Other one is, I'll just make you one point about the Electoral College, because this is one that comes up. I actually, because of, this tells you a lot about me, I actually wrote a novel about an Electoral College mashup.
That's the single dorkiest thing I've ever heard in my life. But it sounds cool.
Well, it actually sold more. They actually wanted to make a movie out of it, so go. It was a satire. The point about it is that, and then what happened was with the 2000 election, what I wrote was not weird enough. Okay.
Right.
So here's my question. You abolish the Electoral College, and now you have an election in which, as has happened often in the last elections, you have 10 or 12 states. You have a race like 1960. 70 million people vote, 100,000 votes separate Nixon from Kennedy, maybe.
Maybe.
Humphrey Nixon, 500,000 votes out of 100 million. Gore Bush, 500,000 votes, right? In which case, you don't just recount hanging chads in Florida. You got a system where you now have to recount 100 million votes in 50 different states with 50 different processes. And if you think Gore versus Bush was a nightmare.
I do.
Well,
I do.
Welcome to the direct election of the president and probability theory, because sooner or later that's going to happen, because it's happened more often. Anyway, but I take your point that we're not going to have a constitutional convention.
Not this week.
Okay. Now, here, this is, you're being chastised here mildly. On
okay.
Syria, David,
yeah.
You sidestepped the essence of Jeff's question. Not what is the right position with regard to Syria, but whether Obama's actions were clumsy, and if yes, did that weaken the standing of the United States?
Yes, they were. I didn't mean to sidestep, but I apologize. The business of forming a policy by, as my mother would say, passing a remark at a press conference, and then the Russians take you up on it, and did not seem to be the height of Dean Acheson-like probity. But I don't mean to make light of this situation. It is a horror.
I like to end these things with a kind of as broad a question as possible, and it's often the same one, which is, when you look at where we are, I'm talking about the country, not the magazine, which is in good shape, can you describe yourself more as optimist or pessimist?
I think in the introduction you mentioned my background. We have a cartoonist named Bruce Eric Kaplan, who also writes episodes of Girls. He is the darkest cartoonist imaginable. He's the Samuel Beckett of cartooning. I seem to buy his cartoons more than anybody else. But I also have children, and I also am lucky enough to live here. And at the risk of banality, I have enormous optimism about both. All our flaws aside, when you look at the world in all its horror, you realize there are fewer people starving to death than there were. Medical advances are beyond imagination. Human capacities are what they are. None of this fully erases anyone's tragic view of history or the fact that we all expire and all the obvious things. But I have enormous hope that doesn't evaporate even under the worst kind of pressure. So I guess against all my better instincts, I am optimistic.
And as Russ Cole said at the very end of True Detective, which was one of the darker television programs in history, that he thinks maybe the light is getting the better of it.
Well, look, in 2007, Dorothy Wickenden, who's my good pal and the executive editor of The New Yorker, said, "I will make you a bet that Barack Obama can be elected president." And I laughed and laughed, and I said, "That is just absurd. This country is just not ready for that." Now, that's not the only barometer for optimism, and I realize that nearly everybody in this room has one complaint or another, or worse, or more, about Barack Obama. But you cannot tell me that day that election was an enormous advance in the history and psychology of this country, and particularly for particular populations of this country, which are growing and growing, and give them a sense of belonging and empowerment and possibility that didn't exist before.
So when people ask me, why do you keep coming back to the 92nd Street Y year after year?
For the food.
For the food. But the truth of the matter is, it's because I get to sit down for an hour and a half with someone like David Remnick.
Thank you. Thank you. Thanks. That was very fun, Jeff. I appreciate it. Oops.